Upstairs at Froelich's, show 410, reel one.
It's interesting. My wife comes in and watches, and she's like, "Is that Ralph Macchio?" And I'm like, "Yeah." It's like, "Wow, he hasn't really seemed to age all that much compared to everybody else." Everybody else has aged really bad, especially Johnny Sins.
Well,
my God,
Zabka still looks good. He's just aged more in the face. He's got some wrinkles and everything.
And his voice,
like that.
Also, his voice has not changed. You know, it's still the same voice.
Now Thomas Ian Griffith, he. Okay, yes.
Oh, my
Terry
God, that guy.
Terry Silver is literally the embodiment of his fucking hair. We get that, okay?
Yeah.
Terry Silver streak. But but body-wise and facial-wise, I mean, he still looks pretty decent. He ain't too worse for the wear, in my opinion. That's my opinion.
I think in his face he's gotten a little old, and he kind of looks like Ronnie Cox now. He looks like Ronnie Cox from the RoboCop movie and Total Recall.
Yuji Okamoto looks pretty good for his age.
That's Chosen, right?
Chosen, yeah.
Tamlin
Tamita is the one who has aged the most. Tamlin Tamita, now, not saying she doesn't look good or nothing like that. I'm just saying you look at Kumiko from Karate Kid 2 in 86 to Cobra Kai Season 3, you take 34 years, and yeah, she's aged up a bit.
She's aged a bit, but I already knew that she had aged because she was on Star Trek Picard playing an evil Romulan spy. And the thing is, she doesn't really talk like that. You know that cute little accent that
she has?
Oh,
yeah, she has...
She's totally Americanized.
Yuji Okamoto is the same way. He has an American accent.
He's like, how are you? I'm fine. But when they're on the show, suddenly it's like, oh, you must catch fly with chopstick. They talk like that.
Well, same thing with even goes back to Pat Morita. Like same thing with Pat Morita.
Yeah,
really
I saw an interview
like,
with
he
him
never
one time.
Like that.
He did this movie
remember that movie Miracle Beach with Dean Cameron?
Yes, I do. With Amy Dolans.
Yeah, Amy Dolans, Dean Cameron. Yeah, he's in that. He plays Gus, the fucking bum, and he speaks normal in that movie. Dude, when I was a kid, that blew me away. Like it did not look like him. I'm like, who is that? He looks so fucking familiar. And then I see the end credits. I'm like, that is fucking Pat Morita.
Pat Morita is everywhere, though. He's another icon of the 70s, because he was like, he was on Happy Days, of course, right?
Yeah, it was Arnold on Happy Days. I can't believe he did an Andy Sidaris movie, that movie Gun. I think he did that with Andy Sidaris. I'm like,
one cannot catch big tits with chopstick. and he was in an episode of one of my favorite episodes of The Odd Couple, where he plays a friend of Felix's from the war, and they invest in a Japanese restaurant together, and of course everything goes horribly wrong. But he winds up getting an Oscar nomination for Karate Kid, and that's you know, the spirit of Morita is in this.
You know the story behind that scene though, like why he got the nomination.
I always assumed it was that time when he got drunk and he was thinking about his dead family.
You are
right?
Absolutely correct. Now, you want to know the funny part? They were going to cut that.
They were going to cut that out.
They were going to cut that scene.
It's Adelson a nice character
even
moment.
Went on
it's
record. He said he was going to cut it, but Pat Morita fought him for it, and they said, okay, we'll keep it in.
Well, that's weird, because that's an Adelson moment. I mean, like, John Adelson is a character-driven director when he's telling stories. If you remove that scene, you remove so much more. And what's more, that scene sort of plays later on in Karate Kid Part 2 as well.
You see, and that's why I'm glad they kept it in, because they were able to build on that scene for the sequel. That's why I don't like the fact that people dog Karate Kid Part 2, because I think it's just as good as the fucking first one, and I think it's better than the first one.
I think it's a lot of fun. I don't think it's as good as the first one, sorry, because
I'm not going to fight anybody. Anybody tells me that they like the first one compared to the second one, I'm like, great. That's awesome, because you are never going to share my opinion. Like Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. That is my favorite Indiana Jones movie, right? But again, it's a biased fucking opinion, because my earliest best memories trace back to Temple of Doom. The Betamax.
Really? Like you got to stop smoking crack.
No. I
enjoy Temple of Doom. It is a bizarrely dark film, and it's very violent.
I will not deny, though, from a production standpoint, that Raiders...
They actually ripped
the
guy's heart out.
Raiders is the better made film, without a doubt. Temple of Doom for me, it's like it just has a better place in my heart. Like, you know, you hear the expression, they swung for the fences with Temple of Doom. They
well,
really
I'll tell
did
you this.
Swing for the fences.
Temple of Doom has a very different color to it. And what's more, the Blu-ray I have this very nice box set. I told you about the box sets that I have.
Yeah,
books.
We got ours when me and the
my
wife
favorite,
got married, we bought it.
My favorite box sets are the ones that are like books, where you flip open pages and a disc comes out, like the, you know, like the one I just bought recently, the Hitchcock Masterpiece, and I also have a Jurassic Park, and
James Bond one. To make an addendum on that, when you're dealing with Blu-ray, that's fine and dandy. I have no problem with that packaging, because Blu-rays are very hard to scratch. But
they are hard to scratch. But it's not a
that
cheap
that type of
it's
packaging on DVDs, though, I'm not too fond of, because that packaging can scratch discs.
Yeah.
So, I mean, but on Blu-ray, it's fine, because you don't get a lot of scratch shit. And I have a lot of Blu-rays that are in that, you know, style of, you know, box set, and they're not scratched at all. But
that particular, I just want to say, that particular restoration that they did of Temple of Doom is incredible to watch. It is so much more colorful to it. This is another thing I have to mention. I know I bitch about this constantly, but HD just looks like crap compared to film, and you can see it when you're looking at the comparisons.
You need to really listen to the new Quentin Tarantino podcast, because they're talking about what you're talking about right now.
But you can
like
see
the reason,
it right there.
I know. The reason that these guys like going back to like the old format is because, like, they said back in the 80s, all the studios actually used, you know, film prints for their home video transfers. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's why a lot of people like watching the older format, because it's like the closest you're ever going to get to watching like a film print that was in the theater when you saw it when you were a kid. That's why, as much as I hate to say it, I kind of like Dark Force Entertainment, because I don't know if you've ever heard of them. Dark Force Entertainment.
Refresh my memory.
Oh, they're an independent company. They released a bunch of Grindhouse movies and stuff like that, like a bunch of Forgotten by the Wayside movies. Like, they did Screams of a Winter Night. They did Dead Pit, Breeders. Point I'm getting to is this. I have this one Blu-ray that they did. It's a double feature with Psycho from Texas and The Gates of Hell, the Lucio Fulci movie, Gates of Hell.
Okay.
Even though that movie exists on, like, this nice fucking 4K fully remastered package, this company released what's called the Grindhouse version of it. It is taken from a actual film print. No cleanup. No nothing. It looks like you're watching.
With all the marks and everything.
It pops, the emulsion lines, all that shit. Like, it actually recreates the whole Grindhouse experience. But at the same time, that's a risky endeavor, because most people aren't going to buy a movie for that aesthetic. They want to see it cleaned up and looking the best.
Well, no. How about this? Instead of that, the people that would be interested in seeing a movie like this may be more interested in seeing it in the way it was presented at the time, rather than, I don't know, when you're talking about like these old ass Grindhouse movies, the people who are really interested in this stuff are the people that followed it for years. So they may want that. I mean, that's kind of why they did Grindhouse, the movie, with all the scratches and everything. You know, I mean, like, Tarantino shot his part on film, but Rodriguez shot his
all
on
digital.
But they tried to spruce it up and make it look really, really... They did a fine job, actually. What I found disappointing about comparing HD to film is look at the color of Daniel's yellow car. In the film, it's a vibrant yellow. In this HD, it's so faded. It doesn't look as rich.
Did you watch it on... Let me ask you this. Did you watch it on streaming, or did you watch
Netflix? I watched it on Netflix.
Okay. Well, you know what, though? They did just come... That may have been an older master that they used, because they did just come out with a new 4K box. Let me rephrase that. It's out of print now, because it was apparently a limited thing, and that pissed me off. I should have bought it when I had the chance.
The movies?
Yeah, they did 1 through 3 in this nice 4K box set. And I should have bought it. I should have jumped on it when I had the chance. It was only $50, dude. I don't know what the hell was wrong with me, why I didn't fucking buy it. I was just being a cheap ass. But now it's out of print. You can't get it anymore. All the transfers were taken from new 4K restorations. So, you know, that vibrant color you're looking for, I guarantee you, if you had, like, TV with HDR10 and a 4K Blu-ray player, yeah, you'd get that vibrant yellow on the car. You get that back.
That's the movie, though. The movie was shot on film. Cobra Kai is shot on HD. Cobra Kai, everything, it's a very low-budget affair, actually, when it comes to behind the camera, because they had original...
Oh, you can tell where the budget constraints are.
We got to talk about that, too. Okay, now, when the show first started, it started on YouTube Red, which was their premium service, and then...
Now known as YouTube Premium. The format still exists. There is no longer original content on it. If that makes sense to you, or do I need to explain?
Well, yeah, no, you don't need to explain. But the way I sort of put it together, it seemed to be like a labor of love between William Zabka and Ralph Macchio, and then Hurwitz and Schlossberg come into it, and Josh Held, and they produce this whole thing. And because Will Smith has like some kind of profit participation or rights, or he controls some of it, he gets a piece of the pie too. Will Smith is also producing for Netflix as well, right? And also his marriage is falling apart, but we don't talk about that either.
Well, he did do that Netflix movie Bright, which I have never and will never watch.
And he also is doing a Fresh Prince of Bel-Air reboot.
I hate David Ayer. I cannot stand David Ayer. He's a hack of a writer. I don't like him. That's why I will never watch Bright. Made one good movie, in my opinion, and he hasn't made a good movie since.
Oh, it's, you know, Will Smith has had kind of a hit or miss career as well. He's known mainly as his most popular movies are very early on, Independence Day and Men in Black, and then after that, the receipts fall off.
Well, no, I mean, okay.
Hey, wait a minute. My boy wrote Training Day, which is an awesome movie.
That's like what that. I said. That was the only good movie he made.
And look at
all the garbage he wrote after that.
Fast and the Furious.
Crap.
He also gets a special thanks for the Suicide Squad.
And then he's an executive producer
on Birds of Prey, so he was part of that. That was kind of like a...
Because of Harley Quinn. He got a credit.
Yeah.
Because of Harley Quinn.
He's not really known for much. Not since 2000. He wrote U-571, which was... Is that that movie with...
That's a submarine movie where Jon Bon Jovi gets his head cut off.
Jon Bon Jovi. I didn't even know the cat was an actor.
Dude, you know he did... You never saw the...
Why are you fucking recommending Jon Bon Jovi to me? I didn't even know that cat could act.
Wait, I'm doing Troy Duffy here, sorry. Wait. You've never seen the sequel to John Carpenter's Vampires? Vampires Los Muertos?
There were two, weren't there?
Yeah, no, there was three.
Weren't there like two direct-to-video sequels or something? Yeah,
the second one, Jon Bon Jovi's the lead fucking guy.
And does he get his head cut off too?
I don't remember. The movie was
garbage. I mean, I know a lot about the first Vampires. That has fucking Terry Silver in it. He's the head vampire.
We all rounds back to fucking Thomas
It all Ian comes Griffin. Back to Terry Silver. To Thomas Ian Griffin. Okay, so what was like... Okay, we were talking about YouTube Red, and I guess YouTube Red collapsed. They sold it to Netflix. Got a bigger audience too, I gotta say, because that's when I started hearing about
that's
Cobra
when
Kai.
That's when the big push happened. Like,
because they were like, the "Oh, over at Netflix, we advertise what we produce."
Yeah. The main thing about season three, that actually had completed production, but then YouTube Red finished. They were shopping. They had to shop season three around to somebody else because remember, Sony doesn't have their own streaming service.
Yeah, that's right. Instead, Sony has
basically Sony's streaming service. Like Netflix and Sony are like in tandem with each other.
I get. Yeah, that's why it's weird. You'll occasionally see a couple of Sony or Columbia movies show up on Netflix. Sometimes it's weird. A Marvel movie pops up too. That new one, what was it with Jared Leto, is on Netflix right now.
Well, the reason being before Disney Plus got their own... Remember, all those Marvel shows, they all aired on Netflix. The original Marvel shows, like Jessica Jones, The Punisher, Daredevil...
Luke Cage,
The Defenders, right. Iron Fist. That was all like Disney working with Netflix before Disney got their own streaming service. And then when they got their own streaming service, what happened? All that shit got pulled, but they still get some... They still have like contracts in place to where they can still air certain movies, but once the contracts expire, they go to
Disney.
That's
right. And you can find them. You can find them on cable. They pop up too, those movies. It's Disney has a stranglehold, so does Paramount now. And what's the other one? Netflix doesn't because they're not an actual like motion picture company.
Well,
but
hold
you have
on.
Sony and Universal are kind of
Netflix. Netflix is a motion picture company. Man, they made the Irish
white
dude.
No, they're a streaming company. They stream. They'll finance, but they stream. And they also spend way too much money. And they also lose all the stuff that made me fall in love with Netflix. The reason I got Netflix If I must get my ears out, I'm going to get my pointed ears out.
Okay.
The reason why is because of Star Trek. They had every Star Trek thing. And then Paramount comes out and just takes everything away. And the only thing that's been keeping me on Netflix right now I'm done because I watched Cobra Kai and that was it. I finished it.
Well,
and I finished
we still have Netflix, and the main reason we're keeping it, Cobra Kai is still running, and as much as I hate to say it, that's about fucking... Oh, wait, no, I forgot Paradise PD. Another different conversation for a different time. That's a show I love. And
is that a cartoon?
It's a cartoon. And it's,
I think I saw a couple of episodes of that.
It's airing in its last season. This last season up in December.
I did watch F is for Family.
Oh, yeah, that show. It just ended. Oh, yeah, I forgot. Stranger Things is why I'm keeping Netflix. Duh.
The last season. You know what? I will... Okay. You know what I'm going to do? And I'm doing this only for you, Froelich. I'm going to try and watch that fourth season. And see what happens. I'm going to try and watch. I walked out 15 minutes into it because I was like, what the fuck? I don't really, you know, why are you doing this? Stop doing this. I like it when it's about the gang. This is the problem. This is one of the big problems I have with every show, including Cobra Kai, is that they just add all these characters in and they take away from the thing that I really like about it, which is Johnny's struggle. The show is about Johnny. It is about him trying to, it's like he is stuck in an 80s museum. He doesn't even understand cell phones. It's like,
okay, the best
he keeps
way to put
talking
it is
about
he's an
hash.
Analog, he's an analog kid in a digital world. That's exactly
but we've
what
okay
is.
But the thing is, all of us, I'm of that generation too. They're a little bit older than me, but I understand cell phones. I understand computers. He's like, he tries to bring his computer back to the pawn shop. He says it doesn't work anymore. It's like, did you plug it in, idiot? And he's like, what? And it's like, he's got this thing, and he keeps talking about hash browns, and he talks about...
Hash brown, Cobra Kai.
Hash brown, Cobra Kai. I mean, like, yeah, he's like a, what's the word, anachronism, I guess, because everybody's talking about... oh, my God. One of these girls is talking about fucking safe spaces and how she likes to be identified by her personal pronouns. He's like, what?
That was season four. That's what pissed me off about season four was because...
No, I think
Netflix...
I think they were making fun of it. I think they were making fun of those kids. Because what is the language that is spoken in this TV show? It's our language. It's not their language. These kids are kind of like, some of them are kind of a joke. But it does come down to the whole bullying thing. It's all about Miguel. He got his ass kicked. He's like, you know, hey, don't mess up my car. What are you messing up my car, beating up this kid for? And it's like suddenly, all right, I'll take you under my wing because you're a pussy. I'm going to teach you how to fight. And he gets motivated to start up, to launch Cobra Kai. And he does all the work himself. And that's what pisses me off because fucking Kreese comes in and takes it out from under him. It's like, I hate Kreese. I hate him with a passion because he's Emperor Palpatine.
I'm sorry, man. I love the guy. I'm glad they brought him back.
I've never. He's, also, what happened with Martin Cove? Because it seems like when he got older, he suddenly got a New York accent. Have you noticed? Did you notice this? Because he does not talk like that in the movies.
You know, you're right.
Is Martin Cove from New York? I got to look this up. I got to see if he's a native New Yorker. And it's like, because my wife was telling me, when you get older, your old accent pops up, you know? Because my mother went, yeah, he's from Brooklyn. He's from fucking Brooklyn. But he didn't talk that way. He wasn't like, he didn't say, you know. He didn't say strike. He didn't go strike force, no mercy. You know, suddenly he talks like that. And it's like my mom is from Nashville, Tennessee. She was born in Nashville, Tennessee. For a long time in her adulthood, she did not have that accent. But then it came back when she hit her like 60s, I guess. She started talking like this, you know, and saying y'all, you know. And I guess that just sort of happens when you reach a certain age, your old accent comes back.
I do like the fact that the show tries to give a little backstory to Kreese, especially in season three. Like, we didn't ask for this backstory, but we're glad we got it because now we kind of understand why he is the way he is, why he's so hateful.
I want to bring that up because I think that's the overall theme of Cobra Kai is there are misunderstandings, and the show seems to be about what you think a person is based on what you've been told,
right?
Based on your history, and then there's this bias that you have. At the beginning, I think in the first episode, Daniel tries to make peace with Johnny and say, look, we were just a couple of stupid kids. Johnny's still a little pissed
off.
Yeah, this whole thing destroyed his life. And he winds up antagonizing Daniel. And then they get into this contest when he drew a big dick.
Well, actually, the whole,
he drew a dick on the billboard.
The antagonistic part started when
he put a dick in my mouth.
Yeah. It wouldn't have been antagonistic if Daniel didn't. So we all know what happened. So let's just say this.
Daniel, season is one, insufferable.
Johnny gets that big check from his stepdad. Well, from his stepdad, basically. You know,
basically a fuck off money.
A fuck off money. Thank you. And then he decides to reopen the Cobra Kai dojo. But then Daniel drives by and he sees that it's reopened. And then Daniel starts, you know, it's like, you're not going to do this kind of stuff. Why are you bringing this stuff back? That's when it starts becoming antagonistic.
He thinks it's all about evil because he's been taught that, or he grew up believing that Cobra Kai was the Galactic Empire and Miyagi-Do is the rebellion. They never attack. Cobra Kai is more offensive than defensive. So it's the karate style. So, and the thing about it is that's what it is that Macchio's character in the first season is insufferable because he's a goody little two-shoes, right?
Yeah.
It irritates. And also, he's got this kid, and like we said, his son there is just, he spends most of his time sitting at the breakfast table on his fucking cell phone. And then he's got Samantha, who he sort of taught karate to, gave up on it or was less interested, but then she gets interested later.
Yeah, right near right at the ass end of season one is when she restarts her training. Like, she goes back to the dojo and she starts training again. They never say what happened, but I think she maybe quit training when she started becoming popular, or right after Mr. Miyagi died.
She was hanging out with all the, you know, the pretty girls.
Yeah,
and
all the mean,
right?
girls.
And then she had her friend. Okay, she had her friend there, Aisha, who I was really disappointed that left the show after the second season because I liked Aisha.
I did like Aisha, but they never said behind the scenes why they did. But I think it was because this could have been why. I think they were trying to push Peyton List, you know, Tori, and then when they were pushing her in season three, they kind of had to give a backseat to Aisha.
I feel terrible because...
Because you're an old man that thinks she's good-looking, and I'm an old man that thinks she's good-looking, too, all right?
She's fucking hot. She's, like, hotter than hell. I mean, she's way hotter than... Samantha's kind of a goody little two-shoes. I like...
Because you're just saying, you like a bad girl. I get how it goes.
I feel like a dirty old man. I feel like a dirty old fucking man because she could be my daughter, you know?
Yeah, I mean... Hey, man, I got a 19. You remember, my
I hate those uncomfortable feelings, 19, man.
So I can't look at
I feel like Dan Schneider. I feel like I'm such a fucking perv. But anyway, I mean, like, okay, it's like you have these setup of these characters. The most important characters to me are Miguel and Robbie.
Yes.
Robbie is Johnny's kid, and he's, of course, he's a deadbeat dad with a... I don't know, a drug addicted or whatever. I don't know what the girlfriend that he knocked up at
the
time.
Well, his ex-wife, whatever she is. They never even say if he was married to her or not.
Johnny doesn't even strike me as the kind to get married. He seemed to me that he would forget where his fucking birth certificate was. That's why I like Johnny. He's very clueless. And what's more, the actor, I mean, I like William Zabka. There were some criticisms about him because they said that he wasn't Olivier, but you don't have to be Olivier to be that character.
No, you don't have to be Olivier.
He has a really refreshing kind of unrehearsed quality about him, and it doesn't seem like he's acting. It just seems like he's just sort of there, you know. Macchio is acting. I mean, it's like Macchio's like this. He's like he's like very Shatner and everything, but Zabka is not. He's not that kind of actor. He's just very natural.
He's basically being himself.
They probably just said, just be yourself. Just say the lines. You don't have to have that much conviction. Just act like you're completely annoyed at what has happened around the last 40 years of your life or something like that.
Just
you know?
Saying I peaked in high school, God damn it. Now I'm just nothing but a drunk loser.
He's everybody. Isn't he everybody? I mean, didn't we all kind of peak in high school in a way? He's... Macchio, that's why Macchio's character is annoying, because he's like, he got everything, he got the perfect wife, he's got beautiful children, he's got the car dealership, he's rich, you know, he's got that gorgeous house,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, but he worked for it, he fucking worked for it, though, you can't...
I guess, maybe, it seems like he's got a lot of help from his family, too. That's another thing, Johnny doesn't have family. He's got Ed Asner, who told him to fuck off, you know, and he's got his son hates him, and his son's a fucking criminal at the beginning, right?
Yep.
And, you know, his ex-girlfriend there, she's a loser, too. She picks up men. She picks up men so that, I don't know, they'll buy her drinks or maybe get married to her and give her money and she divorces her. Maybe she's like a Black Widow type or something. I'm not
She's
really
always
sure.
looking for sugar daddies, basically. That's what she's looking for.
Yeah, I mean, that's her career, right?
Right.
It's like, good for women to have a career, don't you think?
That's all I want to do.
But obviously, Danny had a lot of help. Yeah, his mom is still around. I mean, it's nice to see Randy Heller. Yeah, Ralph Macchio is 60 years old as of this writing. and Mr. Zabka is 56, so he's younger, actually. And also, I mean, fucking Thomas Ian Griffiths is actually younger than Ralph Macchio.
But actually looks
and all
age.
These kids, I mean, like, okay, there's something really kind of depressing, too, because all of Johnny's friends there, they all look so horribly old now.
I know.
And one of them even died. One of them died.
Yeah, because he actually... But you know what? I think it was so cool in season two that even though the actor, Robert Garrison, was terminal at the time, pretty much, like, he was terminally ill, that they brought it, that he was willing to do that episode.
What was... Do you think there was some kind of irony to the fact
that...
Oh, they
already said
he
was the guy who said in the first one, get him a body bag!
Get him a body bag!
And then what do they do?
They
put him in a body bag. I'm just like, oh,
they zip him up. I mean, yeah, he wasn't dead then. He wasn't dead then, but
he
did
die.
He
did die in real life. He did pass away. He was terminally ill. The only one... You know who they couldn't get back, though, and they said why? Literally the only Cobra Kai they couldn't get back was Chad McQueen.
Chad McQueen was...
He was Dutch. He was one of... His name in Karate Kid 1 was
He was
Dutch.
The other big, tall, blonde guy, right?
He was an average height. He had blonde perm. He had a blonde perm.
But he was taller than Macchio because, you know, everybody's taller than Macchio.
Well, the reason he didn't come back is because he owns a racing company or something like that, and they're year-round busy. So, like, he could... Like, he said, it's not that I don't want to do it. I would love to do it. I have no time. Like, he literally has no time to do it. Like, they got all the Cobra Kai's back except Chad McQueen, who said he'd do it, but he couldn't. He had no time because he's just busy with everything else that he's doing in life.
I want to wrap up. What should we wrap up? What should we... Let's very quickly go through the story of season one and two. So, as I say, Johnny gets the Cobra Kai name up and running again. He finds out that there's a kind of a ban because Macchio's character runs on the board. He's on the committee of martial arts, even though he walked away from martial arts a long time ago. He still controls it to some extent. He winds up having to fight for that name to get the name back. And he starts teaching Miguel because Miguel is being bullied. And that's really kind of the whole thing of Cobra Kai, is that you get these kids who are bullied and then you turn them into bullies. And it's not a very good thing. That's sort of like the problem. You know, and who's the character that personifies that? Eli. Eli becomes Hawk and he becomes a complete fucking monster, and he's a monster for like three or four seasons before
well,
he finally
it's
sees the error of his ways.
Just the end of the third season is when he finally comes around. Like, in that first season, it's like in second season, he goes down the fucking, basically, like you allude to Star Wars, the second season, he goes down the dark path. That's when he becomes a bully. That's when he starts, what is it? Him and Dimitri start going at it, you know.
And they're friends. They were all part of a circle of geeks that they were. But I think it started when, you know, Johnny was like, you call him Lip. He was like, do something to take attention away from your lips. So he's like, fuck it. I'm going to get a fucking tattoo on my back, and I'm going to get a mohawk or a faux hawk, actually. And so it does take tension away, and he calls himself Hawk.
And you also notice they purposely did this in the show. They actually decreased the makeup on his lip when he wore the mohawk and got the tattoo.
You didn't notice that? When you say it that way, my attention goes immediately toward his hair, but... I thought that little thing was real, though.
No, that was makeup. That's makeup. That was makeup. He doesn't have a cleft palate or nothing like that.
I thought it was. I mean, why would you do that?
When we're done here, go on YouTube, look up some interviews with Jacob Bertrand. He just looks like a normal kid.
How about a monobrow instead? I mean, or I don't know, a weak chin, why does it have to be that? Jesus. Especially since all these kids are kind of privileged anyway. You'd think he would have gotten reconstructive surgery.
I have a friend, an old friend who had a cleft palate, and he got a good surgery. You know, he got sewn up. I mean, look at Cheech, man. Why do you think Cheech had a mustache for all them years? Because he had a cleft palate.
What he had? He had a cleft palate?
Yeah,
too?
He had a cleft palate. That's why he wore a mustache to hide it.
I've seen him without the mustache a couple of times. Maybe I think in he didn't have a mustache in one movie I remember watching. I forget which one it was. Damn it.
Well, any of the older, like the later movies that he did, like especially like From Dusk Till Dawn, he doesn't have. Like, there's like he plays three characters in there. First character's a border patrol agent. He's not wearing a mustache.
And the second character, he's the guy outside talking about all the pussy you can get.
Yeah.
And then at the end, he's the guy who makes contact with Clooney.
Yeah, and he has a mustache. And that's, I mean, but Cheech, he doesn't do a mustache anymore. Cheech is, nowadays, he doesn't wear the mustache. Oh, Nash Bridges, I don't think he had a mustache.
There you go. That's what I'm thinking of. Nash Bridges, the Don Johnson show. He starts to get people in. Miguel is his first student, but then he brings in all these other students, and then he's got his own dojo. He's got his actual own dojo, and he gets into the All Valley, and Miguel beats Robbie, but he kind of does it in a dirty way by fucking with his dislocated shoulder. And that's basically how the first season ends.
Well, yeah, the first season ends with and Miguel is slightly corrupted at the end of the first season, because that's when he's got the whole, you know, they're the enemy, we have to strike first, you know, that kind of thing. Like, he gets a little corrupted by power, you know, that he's no longer a pussy. He's no longer getting his ass beat by fucking Kyler, you know, and all the other bullies and everything like that.
I hated that guy.
I don't like Kyler. You know, there's a lot of this fucking dick. I don't like Kyler either.
There are you know, they sort of take like this kind of like young soap opera thing happening with this whole thing with Samantha and Miguel, and then the weird triangle between Samantha, Miguel, and Robbie, and then they bring in Tori, and it's sort of like Melrose Place with karate.
You know what? You nailed it. I literally was going to say, I was actually going to say 90210 with karate, but I'll take Melrose Place with karate.
It doesn't irritate me nearly as much as those shows did when they were around. Because, like I said, it's a shorter running time, and it doesn't go on too long.
And it
doesn't
have a lot of these, unlike most soap operas, it doesn't have, like, too many overlapping stories, you know what I mean? Like, this
yeah,
is more
and there's no
confined
unwanted
to, like,
pregnancy subplot
stories,
either.
Stories, maybe four at most, but then most of the ones get, like season five, I know we're talking about season one, two, but let's just put it this way. Season five, they wrap it all up. It's like season five is wrapped up, and now you only got this one thing going on.
Except that, well, season five ends with Kreese, and it's basically when Darth Vader is
exactly
created.
It's just like
he like gets up, he puts fake blood or whatever jello on his and he's like, you know, where is Padme? Is she safe? Oh, in your anger you killed her, Lord Kreese. And he just walks out with a doctor's
that's fucking
on an
great
ID.
Man, I fucking love that shit.
But That's where the whole Star Wars thing comes into it. I had one more thing I wanted to mention because we got to wrap this up. It's 3:30. I want to go back to one of the things that you said earlier on about how, and I said it too, is that this show does not insult its audience intelligence. You mentioned something about it going woke a little bit in the fourth season.
Yes, fourth season it got a little woke.
It may have gotten a little woke in the fourth season, but there was one thing that they managed to keep as a theme, and the theme of the show is two themes: fatherhood and positive male role models. And they do not insult men. This is like one of the few shows that is still out and still around, and it doesn't, and it's being made still in 2022, and it doesn't insult men. It doesn't turn them into buffoons. Yeah, Johnny's a little funny, but he's not a buffoon.
No, he's just favorite word. He's a complicated
character.
That's all he is. He's just, again, analog kid in a digital world.
Plus, they know not to have women fighting men. They keep it separated. I mean, I'm talking about in the official
way. Oh, yeah, and I guess in the official way. We're not talking about
in
the
All Valley.
They
separate it. Yeah,
like
they have their stupid mall fighting and their high school fighting and their what a fucking water park fighting and all that. You know, they do, but the thing is, that's outside, it's in the open and everything. But they do know there are differences between women and men.
Yes.
And that's something that has to be commended now. And that's why, if they do go all the way and they go, well, they're going to lose their audience. But I don't think they're going to do that because they want to keep people watching. They know what happens when you do that.
Mm-hmm. Honestly, brutal fucking honesty.
It's a very male positive
show.
These
first two seasons, but I'm going to be brutally honest, man. They need to wrap it up with season six. You cannot take this show any farther than that. They need to end it with season six. It needs to end.
Well, you know what they could do? I'm not condoning this. I'm not condoning this in any way, but they could continue the show with the young cast. They could have the young cast growing up and actually growing up and maybe becoming adults and learning to integrate some of what they've learned as kids into their adulthood. Maybe they could do something like
from a Hollywood perspective. All I'm going to say is this, and we'll wrap it up. First two seasons are great. I love them. The constant in why these seasons are great is that the original writers, you know, Schlossberg, Held, everybody, they are the showrunners. They have been with it since day one. They are still with the show. The problem with most good shows is that when the showrunner goes away, shit starts to fall by the wayside, okay?
Change in leadership,
If this show has to change showrunners, it could be doomed. It could go south really quick. That's why end it before you get to that point. Breaking Bad aside, we've talked about how Vince Gilligan and Peter Gould were both the showrunners for the first two seasons, three seasons of Saul, but Peter Gould took over after that. But one of the half of the creative force was still there, and in reality, it was Peter Gould's show anyway. He was the one that came up with the Saul Goodman character. Don't switch showrunners. Like, if you have to switch them up, just end the fucking show before it just gets way out of hand. The show's already crazy enough as it is, but crazy in a good way. You know what I mean? It's like it.
Yeah, I sort of noted when the drop in quality happened with Walking Dead. Scott Gimple was running the show for a long time after Frank Darabont left. He did a fine job, but then Scott Gimple left and Angela Kang took over, and that's when the quality began to suffer. It's kind of like Doctor Who after Stephen Moffat left.
It was like the main problem took over. Now, again, this is not a bash towards the new Hellraiser movie because David Bruckner did a bang-up job with it, but this goes back to True Blood. Alan Ball was the showrunner for the first five seasons of True Blood, but then David Bruckner came in and took over the last two seasons, and that's when the last two seasons were fucking garbage.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, nothing against David Bruckner. I do like the guy. I think he's a very talented filmmaker, but...
Well, sometimes you want to get a fresh perspective or something like that. Maybe people get tired of doing the job, and then they just leave, and so they bring in new people. Or they bring in the people that were immediately under them to take over.
You know, and that's not... Sometimes it works.
I mean, Chibnall is a great writer, and he wrote some really great scripts for, like, Torchwood and Doctor Who. But as a showrunner, he's terrible.
Yeah. I mean, same thing with True Blood. David Bruckner directed and wrote a lot of great episodes of True Blood. But as a showrunner, he was not good. I mean, he was not a good showrunner. Yeah. Guys, if you're listening, keep the guys in place. Let them do their thing. If they need to leave, end the show. Because I guarantee you, it'll dip. It will dip in quality. It will be bad. And we don't want that. We don't want that. We want this show to stay as good as it is, because there is no reason a show like this, has no right being as good as it is.
That's true.
It has no right to be this good. And on top of that, it's been consistently good. Yes, there's been a few dips in quality here and there, but overall, it is still a great show. I have a few people who would beg to differ with me. My coworker, specifically, he tuned out. He does not like Cobra Kai anymore because, like,
Dead name him. What's his name?
His name is, I'm just going to say this, CR. That's all I'm going to say. And not Chris.
CR. You know who you are, CR.
His whole argument is what you just said. He thinks it's a little bit too much Melrose Place and not enough fucking Kick-Ass.
Listen, I had to be the first to say I was not interested in seeing this because I thought it was going to be terrible, but I turned out to be completely wrong. Froelich gave it a really good endorsement.
Great endorsement.
And right now, his credit is really good. Froelich's credit is good because of the Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul thing.
So, yeah, my credit's...
It may dip if he recommends a show that does
suck. Credit score is about 750 right now. I want to keep it that way, all right? And I will say this, okay, and we'll leave it on this. Just like you, I had no hope in this show. I saw that first trailer. This was back in 2018. I saw that first trailer, and I said, there is no fucking way this show is going to be good. There is no way. But YouTube Red released the first two episodes for free. I watched them. I'm going to tell you right here and now, I ate a big, fat slice of crow pie. It tasted so bittersweet because I had never been so happy in my life to have been so fucking wrong and how I misjudged a show. Because them first two episodes hooked me, and I fucking got the YouTube Red subscription just so I could finish it. And I watched it twice. That first season, I've been every season, dude, with the exception of four, I have watched twice. Season one, I've watched like three fucking times, dude. This show is nothing short of amazing, and it needs to stay that way. But that being said,
we're not quite done with the show, though, talking about it. We got to talk about it again
We've just stuck our fingers in a few things right now. We got more.
Just maybe the first season. We've talked about the first season. We got to talk about the other two seasons.
But just know the first season is very cut and dry. It's literally just, you know, there are a few twists and turns here and there, like how Robbie wants to piss off his dad by working for LaRusso, but then, ironically enough, Robbie ends up learning balance. He ends up learning a few things, and Miguel, adversely, it's the same thing. Miguel learns how to not be a pussy, you know?
Oh, I have to say, I just want one thing before I forget. Every time Zabka screams quiet, I laugh.
I love that. Quiet!
Every time he goes, quiet! Like, I just laugh. I just have to laugh. It's funny. Because it always makes people shut up right away. No matter what they're arguing about, you suddenly hear, quiet!
Quiet!
Okay. Well, let's wrap it up there. Let's quiet ourselves, and we'll see you again next time.
Have a good night, and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe, guys.